The next talk is about OPAC, an asymmetric PAC protocol secure against pre-computational attacks by Stanislav Jarecki, Hugo Kraftschek, and Yang Chu. And Yang is going to give the talk.
Okay, so good morning. Thank you for the introduction. In this talk, we present OPAC, which is a new password authenticated key exchange protocol with some nice properties. So this is joint work with Stanislav Jarecki and Yuki Irvine at Google Function at IBM Research. And by the way, I'm Jia Mixu at UCL. So let me introduce the background first. So this work is in the context of the problem of password authentication. It is very clear that passwords have become the prevalent tool for authentication on the internet these days. But on the other hand, passwords are vulnerable to virus attacks. So for one thing, it must be human memorable, which means that it cannot have very high entropy. And another thing is that people tend to use the same password, or at least highly correlated passwords, for different accounts, which means that if the adversary somehow obtains the password for one account, then it is very easy to obtain other passwords for the same users' different accounts. So these are password disadvantages. So in the crypto literature, password authentication is usually modeled as a password authenticated key exchange or PAC. So as introduced in a previous talk, so in a PAC protocol, two parties who share the same password interact with each other, and at the end of their interaction, they output the same random session key, denoted as SKP. So this is called symmetric because the two parties share the same password. And one thing to stress is that this is in the password-only setting, which means that the only information shared by the two parties is the password. And in particular, there is no public key infrastructure needed here. So this is reviewing the previous talk, and here's something new. So consider a PAC in a client-server setting. So what if one party is a client and another party is a server? And what if there's an adversary who breaks into or compromises the server? Well, it's very clear that then the adversary will learn the password straight away, and all security guarantee is lost. So how to modify this PAC protocol such that it is resilient to server compromise? Well, it is the topic of a symmetric or augmented PAC, or APAC. So the idea is this. Instead of storing the password itself, the server should store a hash of the password, and it is called the password file. So now, if the adversary compromises the server, what it learns is the password file, not the password itself. And of course, the adversary can launch an offline dictionary attack over the password file, which means that because password has low entropy, so basically the adversary can compute the hash value for all candidate passwords and then compare it with the password file. In this way, the adversary can learn the password, but the time complexity should be around the size of the dictionary. But wait, so what if the adversary does this? So actually, the adversary can compute the hash of the passwords prior to compromising the server. Right? And if the adversary does this, then upon compromising the server, the adversary simply checks the password file against the pre-computed password hash value. And then it can learn the password almost immediately. So this is the so-called pre-computation attack. So in a pre-computation attack, after compromising the server, the adversary only needs around log of the size of dictionary time, because it only needs to perform a binary search. So a very natural question is how to force the adversary to perform full offline dictionary attack, which takes size of dictionary time after server compromise in a PEG protocol. Well, so the basic idea is that the server should store a private random sum as long as a hash of the password and the private random sum. So in this way, pre-computation attacks are eliminated because the adversary doesn't know the private random sum before compromising the server. So this is called strong APEG, which is exactly the topic of our paper. So again, a strong APEG is an APEG which is secure against pre-computation attacks. So set of art of APEG. There have been some formal definitions of APEG many years ago in both game-based settings and UC settings. So UC stands for Universally Composable, not the University of California. Make sure that you don't get confused. Actually, very few APEG protocols are proven secure in either definition. And furthermore, all these proposed APEGs allow for of the aforementioned pre-computation attacks. We believe that this is a very serious flaw of all existing APEGs, to the extent that they don't quite meet the motivations behind the definition of an APEG. Because a PEG which is resilient to server compromise should mean that the adversary, upon compromising the server, should still perform full offline dictionary attack. But this is not the case, as we have seen, due to the pre-computation attacks. So in practice, actually, APEG is rarely used. And for password authentication, it is usually done by password over TLS. So the client sends the password over a TLS channel, and the server, upon receiving the client's message, decrypts and gets the password, and then checks the password over the stored password file. So this is the approach of password over TLS. So let's compare these two approaches. So first of all, we know that APEG is in the password-only setting. Again, it means that there's a client and the server only knows the password and the password file, and in particular, there's no PKI needed. But in password over TLS, it is clear that it needs a secure channel. Another thing is that in an APEG protocol, the server actually never sees the password in the clip. On the other hand, in password over TLS, the server, upon receiving the client's message, has to decrypt and see the password in the clip. So these are the disadvantages of password over TLS. But password over TLS does one thing good, which is it can store private random sums in the server. Therefore, the adversary is required to perform full offline dictionary attack upon server compromise. But on the other hand, in APEG, as we have seen, it allows for pre-computation attacks. So our strong APEG combines the good parts of the, both of the two approaches, which is the green text. So it is in the password-only setting. The server never sees the password in the clear, and it does not allow for pre-computation attacks. So our contributions, so first of all, we present the first definition of a strong APEG in the UC settings. So in password cryptography, UC settings have various advantages over game-based definition as listed here. And secondly, we propose two highly efficient realizations of strong APEG in the random Oracle model. And we prove them secure in the UC settings, in our UC definition. So here's our definition. This picture is the UC APEG functionality as defined in the Crypto 2006 paper. So if you take a look at the functionality, the gray text actually artificially allows for pre-computation attack. So the gray text is exactly what the adversary does in a pre-computation attack. So our UC strong APEX functionality is exactly the same with their APEX functionality, with the exception that the greatest is omitted. So in this way, we don't allow for pre-computation attacks. So this is our definition. Here's our construction. So both of our constructions use a critical tool called Oblivious Pseudorandom Function, or OPRF. So this is a way of computing a PRF value. So the client who holds the input interacts with the server who holds the PRF key, and the client learns the PRF output without knowing the key. And in the previous paper of ours, we present a very efficient UC OPRF called DH OPRF. So DH stands for Diffie-Hellman. And here's our strong APEX construction, the first one. So it is a compiler from any UC OPRF and any UC APEX to a UC strong APEX. So the client and the server first engage in an OPRF with the client using the password as the OPRF input. And the output, the PRF value, is called RW for randomized password. And in the second stage, the client and the server exactly do an APEX, except that the password is replaced by this RW, the randomized password. So why is this a strong APEX? Well, you know, if you have done any UC proof, UC proofs are always complicated. But the idea behind the proof is actually very, very simple. So why can't the server perform pre-computation attack and normal APEX? Well, because the password has low entropy. And essentially, the adversary can brute force over the password dictionary. But here, thanks to the PRF key K, the randomized password is random to the adversary with high entropy. So therefore, the adversary, although it can perform pre-computation attack on the password, it cannot do the same thing on this randomized password, which is used in the APEX. So in this way, we eliminate pre-computation attacks. So this is our first construction. Our second construction is a compiler from UC OPRF and UC authenticated key exchange to UC strong APEX. So again, in the first stage is the same as the first construction. The client computes the randomized password RW. And then, so because in an authenticated key exchange, we require that the two parties hold a private key and random key pair. But here we are in the password-only setting, so the client cannot hold its key. So we let the server store a ciphertext of the client's keys under the randomized password RW as part of its password file. And after the OPRF stage, the server sends the ciphertext to the client. And the client, who has already computed that RW, can decrypt the ciphertext and get its key. And then the client and server just run a normal authenticated key exchange and obtain the second key. And the side note is that for the authenticated key exchange, we require a specific property called key compromise impersonation, or KCI. So actually, it's a compiler from any OPRF and any AKE KCI to a strong APEX. So OPEX is the practical instantiation of the second construction. So it can be very efficient with the OPRF instantiated with DH OPRF. And that AKE part can be instantiated using various protocols. We know that actually very similar protocols have been studied before in various papers. But we believe that we are the first one who analyzed that protocol as an APEX, let alone a strong APEX. Okay, so here's a complete instantiation of OPAQ with HMQV as the authenticated key exchange. So as you can see here, this alpha and beta values are messages sent in OPRF, and that capital X and capital Y are the messages sent in the authenticated key exchange, the HMQV. So the key point here is that the OPRF and HMQV, the AKE, can be integrated. So in this way, this OPAQ can be done in only one mode. Performance analysis of OPAQ with HMQV. So as I just said, it can be done in a single run because these two parts can be done simultaneously. So the computational cost is comparable to the most efficient existing ATAC protocols, as you can see here. So although the number of exponentiations per user is a little bit high, the number of exponentiations per server is actually the least among all the protocols shown here. Some features of our OPAQ protocol. So first of all, it is, as we have seen, it is highly efficient and it is provably secure in again in the UC settings. And our UC proof is modular, which means that it works for any UC OPRF and any UC authenticated key exchange with the KCI property. And secondly, as shown in the previous slide, it combines the good properties of both password over TLS and APAQ. So first of all, it requires no public key infrastructure, it is password only. Secondly, the server never sees the password in the clear. And finally, it eliminates all pre-computation attacks. And this is the only such protocol in the non-PKI setting. And furthermore, it supports TLS integration. So recall that this OPAQ, this strong APAQ, is in password-only setting. It doesn't actually require TLS. But if we have access to TLS, then the ciphertext sent from the server to the client, so if you still remember that, it is the ciphertext of the client's keys under the randomized password. But the ciphertext actually can contain the client's other secrets. Say it can be the client's Bitcoin wallet, or more relevant, it can be the client's TLS signature key. So if we do this, then the key exchange part of OPAQ can reuse the key exchange of TLS. So these two can be combined. We only need one key exchange instead of two. So in this way, we protect the TLS using a strong APAQ protocol, which is compressed to the password over TLS, where the TLS channel protects the password. So finally, there are some possible extensions of OPAQ. So first of all, by adding only one message, it can support explicit authentication, which basically means that the two parties simply abort if they don't get the same key. And another thing is that thanks to the recent result of a so-called threshold OPRF, it is very easy to extend our strong APAQ, our OPAQ, to a threshold implementation, which means that the adversary, so there are not one server, but a virus, say n servers, and the adversary, in order to perform an offline dictionary attack, has to compromise a certain threshold, say T, out of the N servers. So if the adversary fails to compromise T servers, say it only compromises T minus one servers, then it cannot, cannot even perform an offline dictionary attack. So in summary, we present the definition, the UC definition of a strong API, and then we realize this definition using two constructions, and both of them are highly efficient, and they can be integrated with PLS. And this is the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
So do PRFT, is it like a storage server too, or is it fresh for every use, or how is it like? You could imagine that you can just generate local PRFT and then because you don't need it later, right? So do you need to use the key to PRFT later for authentication?
Sorry, can you say that again?
So I'm asking about the key.
Okay, that's small pay, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So the question is okay, for example, is the same key for every user, or like is it like?
Well, so this small pay is used only in OPRF, so it is not used elsewhere.
Okay, but so it's not, do you have to store it on the server? Because if it's not used elsewhere, so they compute the RW. So then the server just needs RW. So he needs the key to recompute it. Okay, I see.
So if the client wants to compute RW using this OPRF, so this OPRF requires that the server stores the PRF key, which is denoted as small package.
Does the key has to be the same for every user, or it could be different for them? I don't know if it's...
Well, so this key K can be the same for different users. Yeah.
More questions? Okay, then let's thank all speakers for the session.